as Commissioner Matthews said, I'm the Executive Director of the Public Service Commission, and I have the honor today of moderating this panel with the Chairman, Michael Schmitt, and the Vice Chairman, Robert Cicero. So I'm not going to go into a lengthy bio on these gentlemen. I think you're pretty familiar with them. If you're not, you can go to our website and read about them. So we had decided, or we had thought initially, that we would give you some updates on some major initiatives that are going on at the commission, water loss investigation, damage prevention program that's just that we've implemented within the last year, and then just some updates on the PSC as an organization generally. But yesterday, these two adventurous gentlemen decided that they would prefer to just take questions from the audience. So I'm going to open it up to you to ask questions. And if there are not enough questions, we'll talk about some of the stuff I mentioned. But this is your chance. So ask what you want. Yes.
Wow. We don't have enough time to adequately respond to that question. Martin County has had a lot of serious problems for more than 25 years, and those problems have basically been a lack of adequate management, a failure to periodically request rate increases, and when rate increases were given, the rate structure or rates that were intended to replace infrastructure were in fact used for operation and maintenance. As a result, it's down to the point where the entire system essentially needs to be replaced, and we've seen estimates at $13.5 million or so. Recently, Hal Rogers, Representative Rogers, and Governor Bevin, along with through the auspices of Secretary Snavely, have provided, I think, a little over $7 million to that water system. But the much of the system which serves the eastern part of the county along the Tug River will need a lot of additional money to replace water meters and to replace water lines. So we have advocated the use of a third-party management company to basically come in and run the system. Quite honestly, local residents have basically been opposed to that for fear that the costs will be excessive, and because they have some local pride in wanting to operate their own system. However, I think professional management, I think the commission feels, is absolutely necessary in order to get that system up and running. The problem with rural water districts to start with is the fact that they were all put together in the 1960s, the legislation, and there was no thought of essentially requirements for being general manager, training, and as a result, what we've got is you have a lot of people who are, they can't see the fact that if you spend a little money now to keep your system operating, you actually save money in the long run. The old stitch in time saves nine. But they allow the system to deteriorate to the point where then it becomes so expensive to fix it, they continue to resist investing in the system because they don't want to continue to raise rates until at some point it collapses. And Martin County system has simply collapsed, and unfortunately there are probably a half a dozen or more others in the state, most in eastern Kentucky, which are in about almost the same condition. So we're doing our best to help Martin County fix its problems, but we're probably a long way away from actually doing that, being able to do that. Commissioner Cicero, you may have a response.
Well, Martin County was, it's a multiple failure because Martin County lived for a great deal of time on abandoned mine land money to operate just their day-to-day operations. And when that started to dry up, in addition to the economic downturn that Eastern Kentucky has seen, they not only didn't receive the money they were receiving that they shouldn't have been using for operating and maintenance, but then the economy started to collapse, people started to move out, so the rate base was less. So you had these compounding factors that were impacting them, and now we have this situation where Martin County does not have the rate base really to support the infrastructure that's needed to be repaired, and there is a lot of local resistance to what, as the chairman mentioned, with the outside management group, but we don't see an alternative in order to bring the type of expertise that needs to be applied to this situation. And it's not just the water lines that are in bad need of repair. I mean, it goes a long way into the water plant itself, into the pumps, and some of the money that they've received in terms of grants have to be used specifically for certain projects, which doesn't usually include the normal replacement of lines. And the whole time that they were using the money from the abandoned mine fund for operating and maintenance, they weren't putting anything into a reserve account. So they didn't build up anything for the future. They were living off borrowed money for the present, and now they've got this collapsing infrastructure along with a declining rate base, and they become the poster child for the national news and the local news and for politicians in general. But as the chairman mentioned, it's a situation that if you look at several of the water companies or the utilities in Kentucky, they have problems that will, we were doing our investigation on the leaky 11, as we call them, but I think that's just the tip of the iceberg, and not to go beyond that, but I heard regionalization mentioned this morning, and I guess Kentucky does lead the way, which scares me, because I see so much resistance from local utilities to regionalize, when I think everybody could agree that it's just like 120 counties in Kentucky. There's more administration for the landmass than is needed, and it's the same with the water utilities. We can have two or three local water utilities in the same county, and it's just not necessary. In some cases, there's a commission that doesn't even actually operate a water utility. They contract out, there's commissioners, and then they sell even to other outside utilities. So all they're doing is earning their commission to, quote, have a water utility. So I know it went farther than Martin County, but.
No, but I think it makes sense to go beyond Martin County, because Martin County's not the only county that's been, you know, harmed by the loss of the coal severance funds and the economic impact of that, and how that has, again, like you said, the loss of the jobs has decreased the economic base there. So.
Well, one could argue that coal severance tax money should never have been used to subsidize rates. The rates ought to be adequate to keep the system up and running and operating. But when you get a system like, we'll say, Martin County, or there are several others, where at some point you have a water loss of 70%. So 70% of the water that is actually produced or purchased never gets to the customer, and that costs a lot of money. And much of it is due to leaks. And we're finding that much of that water loss is due to the fact that although these water districts are required to test meters after 10 years, many of them have meters that are more than 10 years old and have never been tested. And our own experience in checking into that has been that many of these meters register zero. So you have a lot of customers in rural water districts who are not paying for the water that they actually use, but they're only paying the bare minimum. And of course, then the system is subsidized by basically the other ratepayers who are paying more. But even the water meters, the old water meters over 10 years of age that are registering something, are usually 10, 15, or 20% slow, they say, so that the water loss, so they're only registering 75 or 80, 85% to the customer of the water that's actually being used. And of course, that's just all part of the formula for economic ruin.
And I got to add to that. The situation becomes complicated for the Public Service Commission because the financial analysis is done on the revenue requirement. And when you have meters that are reading 10 to 20% slow or low, and you have no meters and the utility isn't making an effort to find those customers that either have put in a straight pipe or just never had a meter, or it's a zero read meter, you can't really do an analysis of what the revenue requirement is because we can't be certain what the revenue requirement would be if they actually manage the utility the way it should be managed. And I also heard someone this morning talk about sometimes the level of, I don't want to call it sophistication, but the management practice that's applied is less than what it should be. So what we end up with is there's people that really understand how to make repairs but don't really understand the financial aspect of it. And if people would be as interested in collecting the revenue for the water that's actually delivered, we know that the water percentage would be, I think for Martin County, it's definitely less than 70%, and I think we've determined for Southern, it's less than 62%, but we don't know. So we have to try to set a rate based on water consumption that we know is wrong. And that's the reason why the $58 flat rate got applied in Southern Water District, because we couldn't determine what the water consumption was.
Now, we were told by Southern and the county fiscal court in Floyd County, the new elected members, were intelligent enough to understand they needed outside help in managing that system. And so they hired Utility Management Group out of Pikeville, which runs Pikeville's municipal system, to operate their system at least temporarily. And they found 750 water meters which were registering zero. And a number of people who were receiving water but had no meter at all. And that's why we had to have people complain about a flat rate, but how do you charge a volumetric rate when we don't know, have any idea what the volume really is? Yes. The Public Service Commission should never be in the business of managing a water district or any utility. However, it's terrible when you have a duty to the public to see if you see one of our missions is to basically see that safe, wholesome drinking water is supplied on a reliable basis at a reasonable price. And unless the Public Service Commission or some other regulatory body in this state can have the authority when certain criteria are met, such as a total failure of management, to basically be able to operate the system, to pay its bills, or to provide decent water, some regulatory authority needs the ability to come in like the Department of Education does or can in terribly run school districts, to come in basically and remove management and make arrangements for somebody to go in and at least for some temporary period of time to take over and operate the utility and train the necessary people to conduct its operations. Otherwise, people are paying more for a bad service and unreliable water. And I noticed when the gentleman was speaking about bourbon, I thought, you know, it's unfortunate, but there are several people, several communities in this state who will get a harder kick out of their drinking water than they will out of 100-proof bourbon that Jim Beam would sell in the liquor store.
You know, adding to that is the fact that our only alternative for enforcement is to, like in Marin County, for example, we've had an open investigation that's been going on since right after I arrived at the commission almost 3 years ago. And we also have an ARF, the rate case that's open that we're still dealing with and trying to set them up into the management company. But our only option if we can't do anything is to put them into receivership, which we're not sure who that benefits. It certainly doesn't benefit the customers of Martin County. And since we don't have any really regulatory authority other than our orders that come out and try to persuade changes, there's no penalty that we can assess, and in which case it would only go to the ratepayers anyway. So it's a very difficult situation in terms of bringing utilities that are failing up to standard.
Questions? I'm going to move on from water, maybe talk about something else while we're up here. Yes, Linda. So are you talking about the mandatory membership conversation
Yes.
that was had earlier this morning? Okay. I just wanted to clarify because it's a broad area.
Well, with respect to the natural gas and hazardous liquids lines that we regulate, compliance or getting compliance is something that's going to just take some time, I'm afraid. When before the Public Service Commission was granted the authority or came into the authority to basically enforce the statutes relative to digging around natural gas lines, I think we held, or our staff held, more than 50 meetings across the state with people, and it was close to a couple thousand people who participated in those meetings. Since we came into the authority to enforce the law, we have had several programs across the state in conjunction with usually our attempt to meet with municipalities, county governments, relative to natural gas safety regulations in general, and our enforcement of the federal regulations under Title 49 of the Code of Federal Regulations. But it's been inadequate because I think as of a couple of days ago when I spoke at the at our joint seminar with PHMSA in Louisville, we had maybe 1,250 reports of damage in violation of the dig law from July 14th of 2018 until what, Tuesday, Wednesday or so of this week. And of those, I mean, we've assessed penalties of just under $1 million and have collected more than $800,000 in penalties. But until, I don't know what to do, other than we have used, as I said then, all of the fine money or civil penalty money that has come in is dedicated to basically education and training, so that we intend on providing training over the next 12 to 18 months and beyond, basically in connection with or conjunction with League of Cities, CAICO and others, where we hope to provide free of charge seminars so that people can go to them. We've advertised We have an expensive advertising program on the UK football and basketball network. Any of you listen to the ball games on radio, you'll hear those. We have a new program that we've agreed to earlier this week in connection with or conjunction with the Kentucky Transportation Cabinet, which will be basically going around throughout the state through schools to educate students about the necessity of calling 811, and hopefully that will help in the future, and maybe they'll tell their parents about it. But beyond that, beyond spreading the word, I'm not sure of what we can do at this point. Perhaps Commissioner Cicero has other ideas on it.
I'm not sure I have other ideas, but one of the other trainings that we're doing is the mock line kit that is going on in 5 parts of the state, and that should help as far as the education. Other than that, I think that the enforcement portion of it and showing that the commission is serious about enforcing the violations is probably going to be one of the best educating factors. The commission is holding hearings on a monthly basis for those violators that have failed to pay their fines. And it's usually those that, it took a while for the commission to staff adequately in order to issue the penalties and the demand letters, and for the time to make people realize that we were going to enforce this and we were going to take it very seriously. Some of the larger utilities ran up some large invoices or bills due to fines, but there was also a lot of small ones, and they could mitigate the $1,250 down to $250 by attending a training session. Now, there was some that that agreed to attend the training session and then didn't attend, so the $1,000 became due and payable, and they were ignoring the fact that they owed that additional $1,000, and so we've been holding show cause hearings on a month-to-month basis and intend to continue those. And I think once people start to realize that there are consequences, and so part of this education is making people aware of the consequences, that it will have a bigger impact, and hopefully those number of violations will start to come down, and it will have a positive impact. But other than education and making people aware of the consequences, I'm not sure. In the meantime, there'll be a lot of advertising on UK football and basketball, and the message will be out there.
Someone suggested that we advertise on public radio, but we didn't think necessarily that most of our excavators would be listening to the opera and some of the other things on NPR. But have we done that? Don't we have a contract with them?
We did, just with the Broadcast Association. We just finalized that, and we will be advertising there. And again, with the UK, one of the reasons to do that advertising was, and something that surprises some people when we do the trainings, is that the homeowners are, have to call 811 too, and then they can, they can't just go out and dig on their own property before calling 811, and that is the audience that we were trying to reach, with our, one of the target audiences that we're trying to reach with those ads, because they're statewide. The UK Sports Radio Network is Pikeville to Paducah, as you all know, so that was one of the reasons for that. Linda, did that answer your question? You have any follow-up? Okay.
I just thought it was a good time, since we were talking about the legislation
this morning, to talk about where we're headed. Yeah. And, I would just note that depending on what the legislation, I don't know what's going to come up in the session, but, our enforcement is, as the chairman said, just as to natural gas and underground hazardous liquids. So all the other, utility sectors, there's not the enforcement. I don't know if you've ever taken a look at the enforcement provisions, but it's basically anybody within that jurisdictional area where it happens, any government entity can choose to enforce. Well, that's not really happening. So, and that's one of the things we got dinged on from PHMSA was there was no enforcement on the gas side. That's why we had to make the change that we did to be designated as the enforcement entity. So, you know, that's definitely an issue.
Yes, if we hadn't made the change, we would have lost our funding.
Yeah, they would have.
That was important.
They found us deficient 2 years in a row, so. Who else is out there that I can't see that might have a question? No? I know. Oh, there we go. We got some back there.
What was the question? I couldn't hear the question.
I know. It was hard to hear all of your question.
I don't know that we've basically addressed that issue or even considered it, so I don't know the answer to that question. You know, we're holding, we've opened a dialogue with anyone who would care to comment about the change in the net metering law, so that everyone, utilities, members of the solar industry, customers can essentially provide information that we intend to read, use, and rely on when ultimately we have to make decisions relative to net metering rates. But as to your specific question about the connection issue, I don't know the answer to that. Commissioner Matthews might. She's not on the panel, and I don't know if Commissioner Cicero does or not.
I just know we're having a public, I don't want to call it hearing, a public meeting on October 22nd, 15th.
It's in November now. No. We just changed the
date. We moved it to November,
yeah,
to give more time.
To give more time. The comments are due by the mid-October.
Right. And that's being done in anticipation of eventually the rates being set by the Public Service Commission when a utility comes in and decides that they're interested in a solar rate. They have to come to the commission, obviously, to set that rate. And we are trying to establish at least some experience from comments that we receive on how we're going to apply that. So, I mean, we aren't very far on that at this point.
Do you have anything to add, Commissioner Matthews? Yeah. That was not part of the change.
What'd she say?
She said she doesn't expect. Thank you. All right, I think there was someone behind in that same general area that had a question. No? Okay. I was imagining it. Again, lights in my eyes. So, what about any other questions before we go?
I couldn't hear the question.
The question was that when we're talking about water, we were talking about utilities making insufficient investment in infrastructure. And his question was, he said he's heard other utility customers complain about utilities making too much investment. He wanted to know what the happy medium is.
So I think it depends on what utilities you're referring to in terms of, is it electric, gas, water. Water utilities in general, absent larger water utilities, have a general desire to keep rates low. So the commission finds that usually those operators are reluctant to make the investment because they don't want to impact their ratepayers. So we have to prod them along to put in a reasonable rate that allows them not only to operate, but also to hopefully build a reserve so that they can make the investment they need to. So if you set those aside and then go to the electric and gas, those are a different level of utilities with a lot more sophistication. And in terms of the gas industry in general can earn a greater return if they have an ROE that's on the investment that they're putting into the ground. So you'll see them, we had a case this year where we had to refuse to allow capital investment that we thought was excessive because the rate of growth of the asset value of the utility was increasing at an exponential rate that it was going to go from about a $200 million company to a $1 billion company in about 10 years, earning a return on those assets. But the failure or the condition of the gas pipeline wasn't such that that the commission felt that that kind of investment was necessary to put that burden on the ratepayers. So from the gas side of it, we said that's too much of an investment. You need to ratchet it back down. We'll look at your pipeline replacement program for those types of pipes that we know have been identified as being a safety issue. And so we allow you to do this accelerated replacement and put that investment in above and beyond what we would consider a normal capital investment. So we do permit that, but we don't want it to reach the point where we're just putting in investment in order to increase the potential for return on equity. As far as the electric companies go, transmission seems to be the big thing now because generation just doesn't seem to be a necessary part of it. Unless you're going into renewables, there's really no need for, nobody's building any coal plants, and gas has been identified as one of those terrible ungreen monsters. So if it's going into renewables, that's one thing, but that the technology is really not there yet. So transmission lines seems to be a way to increase the return on equity, and FERC has allowed some additional LIBOR points in order to increase that. But the commission looks at that. Unless there's an actual need for that, those transmission lines, we are not going to look favorably on permitting that to happen. So you come in for a CPCN, justify it, no problem. In the case, for example, of Brady Industries and Ashland, where the commission gave a contingency order that permitted them to build after Brady Industries showed that they had the financing. And once they show they have the financing, then Kentucky Power already has permission to go ahead and build the transmission line. But we prefer not to have utilities spending money for capital investment just for the sake of investing capital to earn a greater return. So that's the reluctance.
Yeah, the balance is between safety and reliability on the one hand and a reasonable price to the customer on the other. And in terms of the water utilities, what they have never had really, other than maybe on one or two occasions in the past, was a program to replace aging infrastructure. And we have determined where they are unable to recover in rates revenue lost because of high water loss. We are trying to basically develop a structure that would allow them to have sufficient money subject to direct Public Service Commission supervision so that the money could be used only to replace aging infrastructure, water lines, meters, treatment facilities, and so forth. And we, in a rate case with Kentucky American Water a few months ago, they asked for a qualified capital improvement program, which we granted. And we granted that based upon our plenary powers, as we understand them, because there was no statutory basis for it. But obviously, infrastructure needs to be replaced in water as it does in every other type of public utility. And the commission can't do its job unless it has some ability to regulate beyond the general confines of statutory approval.
And you're talking, when you're talking about other mechanisms, the surcharge mechanism, yeah, for example. Mm-hmm. Else that I can see or not see. Let's see where we are. We've got about 5 minutes left, or I think, do you take the 5 minutes to wrap up, Secretary, or? So, yeah, do you have any closing thoughts that you want to share?
I don't know. I think we've tried to make a solution to the water loss problem a priority for the commission, and we don't normally talk about water because we look at it as an energy thing. We don't regulate a lot of sanitation districts, which is a surprise to a lot of people. We do have a lot of input into the water utilities, and we've, over a period of time, especially with Martin County kind of leading the way, we've found out that the water utilities are in a, at least the smaller ones are, and there's some good ones that are run, but we are at the tip of the iceberg. There are going to be more problems that come out over the next few years because infrastructure is not being addressed, reserves are not being maintained, there is no money for these utilities to make the investment they need to make. They come in, it's a never win situation. They start to go over the 15% allowable limit that the commission permits. After that, water costs associated with water loss above 15% are not permitted. So they end up not receiving enough money to cover the operating and maintenance costs. They aren't putting anything into a reserve already, and they're caught in this trap of not being able to do anything, which is why I think we're coming to where the chairman mentioned about these surcharges, because we can't find any other way to permit funding for these utilities in order to bring that infrastructure up to where it needs to be. And the grants that are being provided, they do provide for economic development, and they have a lot of other restrictions on them. And as I said before, those don't really help on issues like water meter replacement and some of the other items that need to be done, pipeline replacement on the mains for lines that already exist. So the only thing to do is through a surcharge.
Yeah, the only other thing I'd add, and it just not to get into something new, but we have been for the last maybe year and a half or so working on a plan or a restructure of investor-owned utility programs which are designed to benefit low-income ratepayers. These programs are not uniform. And the qualifications or the requirements to be able to participate in the program are not the same across utility lines. All investor-owned utilities have done a very good job of developing programs, but over the years, over the last 19 years of those programs, they have drifted apart in terms of consistency. And so we intend to open a couple of cases within the next month or so to work with these utilities to try to make the programs more uniform so that customers, for instance, in Northern Kentucky and Duke's territory don't have the same benefits available to them that they do in Kentucky Power's territory or Louisville Gas and Electric or Kentucky Utilities. So I don't want to get into any particular details about that, but I did want to think it's important to let everybody know that that we are interested to the extent that we have any authority to control it, and we do, I think, because of our there are involuntary donations from customers that are attached to everybody's utility bill. So we hope to be able to work with all of our utility partners in helping to alleviate some of the pain that our low-income customers have to endure.
Okay. Thank you both. Thank you all for asking questions, and that concludes the panel.